Hello all, this is Dr. Alsup, and we are going to finish our discussion of the bones of the upper limb with all the bones of the wrist and the hand. And really, this is where that number count of bones goes up, because there are considerably more bones in this region than all the rest of the upper limb. So, we will start with the carpus or the carpal bone. So that's going to be associated with the wrist. We are going to have 8 bones there. We will then move to the metacarpals and then finish with the phalanges or your distalmost bones of the upper limb. And I am going to kind of cheat. I will have separate videos in terms of the joints, some of the larger joints of the upper limb, but I am going to talk about the joints associated with the hand region here in these videos, because I think it's a little bit easier to conceptualize when we're talking specifically about the bones. There's a lot less ligaments and so forth to consider, so we will talk about these joints here with the bones. Okay, so let us start with the proximal most portion of this video, and that will be the wrist. And a lot of times you hear these referred to as the wrist bones. This whole region would be referred to as the carpus, but more often you will hear these bones referred to as the carpal bones. And the carpal bones are divided into 2 rows. You will have a proximal row and a distal row. So the proximal row would, as its name suggests, be more proximal and closer to the radius and the ulna. And then the distal row would be closer to the metacarpals and the phalanges. And I do expect you to know the names of the carpal bones. I'm not going to have you identify all of them, say in a practical setting, but I do want you to at least be familiar with the names. And so you can see here from lateral to medial, the proximal row will have the scaphoid, the lunate, the trichetrum is kind of deep here because that pisiform is sitting right on top of the trichetrum. And I love the pisiform because this is an example of a sesamoid bone. It will form in the flexor carpi ulnaris tendon. So this is one of the named sesamoid bones of the body. The patella will be the other set. And then when we're talking about the distal row, we are going to have the trapezium and the trapezoid. Moving to the capitate, which is the largest of your carpal bones, and then the hamate here. Now, the most frequently fractured carpal bone is going to be the scaphoid. And let me kind of go back to this last image just so you can get an idea of where that scaphoid is. It is going to be the lateral most in the proximal row. It is very closely articulating with the radius right here. And so you can see in this radiograph a very clear fracture, kind of right in this midline region, or middle region, excuse me. And this will often happen with those falls with the outstretched hand. You have that palm facing out, the hand could be slightly abducted, and this could lead to a fracture of the scaphoid. Now, this is often misdiagnosed early because oftentimes that clear fracture that we see in this radiograph, if you do it almost immediately after the injury, it often doesn't show up very clearly on the radiograph. Usually it doesn't become as clear as what we saw here until after a few days, where the vascular supply in this region really kind of starts to break away this bone in this region. And because that blood supply is pretty, it's not very robust in this region. So you can nick that blood supply, and then you actually start getting bone death in this region, or avascular necrosis, AVN, which is where you're basically you lose that vascular supply of the bone, often due to a fracture kind of nicking that very, you know, limited supply that there was to begin with, and you can start getting a clearer view of where that fracture occurs multiple days after the injury when the necrosis begins. All right, so those carpal bones, if you kind of hold your hand out with your palm you know, kind of facing you, those carpal bones are going to form this kind of concave space right here. And it's not to say that this area isn't filled up with stuff, but if you just had the carpal bones, you would have this nice, fairly obvious concave space formed by those carpal bones. And then over the top or the roof of this region, you'll have what's referred to as the transverse carpal ligament that's connecting these bones from one side to the next. It's not so much a joint, more of a kind of overarching protection region. Sometimes you hear that transverse carpal ligament referred to as the flexor retinaculum. All right, so now we basically have a tunnel, as the name would suggest. So you have a tunnel between the carpal bones and this ligament, and then a lot of stuff goes through that relatively small area. And the main components are going to be the tendons and the tendon sheaths, or those bursae-like things surrounding those long tendons of the flexor muscles. And those flexor muscles, the bellies are going to be in the forearm, and then those long tendons have to travel through the carpal tunnel in order to get to the hand, because eventually they're going to go attached to the phalanges. So the tendons are quite long. They have those tendon sheaths surrounding them, and they're traveling through the carpal tunnel. But also importantly, you're going to have a nerve that travels through there. And I like how this image just straight says nerve. How about we add what that nerve is, which is the median nerve. And the median nerve is going to innervate portions of the forearm, but it will also innervate muscles associated with the thumb. So if you have a pinching in this region, it could affect that. And so that's really what we're talking about with carpal tunnel syndrome. And so all those structures are traveling through this relatively small space. There are those carpal bones. Here is the ligament. There are those tendons. That white is representing the tendons. And also, super importantly, you have all these bursae-like structures that are surrounding and, you know, helping to deal with the amount of friction that we would have in this area. But with overwork in that region, or with a lot of friction in that region, these tendon sheaths can swell or become inflamed and swell. And so that can lead to compression of the median nerve and that nerve that's in there. And if there is compression of the median nerve, it's not going to affect the innervation of the forearm muscles because it had already sent off those branches before it got to the carpal tunnel. But what it can affect is the hand. And specifically, it does provide a considerable amount of sensory innervation to the hand. And so that can lead to tingling or just an absence of sensation or maybe a diminished amount of sensation. And like I mentioned, it is going to provide efferent or motor innervation to the muscles of the thumb. So you could have, or those intrinsic muscles of the thumb, the ones that are solely within the hand. So that could lead to a loss of coordination or a loss of strength to the thumb. All right, moving distally now. So there are these carpal bones. I'm going to kind of just outline them here. And they are going to, the proximal row will articulate with the radius, whereas the distal row is going to articulate with the metacarpals. And the there will be 5 metacarpals. These will be numbered from lateral to medial. So recall, in anatomical position, the palm is facing anteriorly, so that makes your first digit or your thumb lateral with the palm facing anteriorly. So first digit or your thumb digit will be the first metacarpal. This will be your second, third, fourth, and fifth. And so these joints that are formed between the metacarpals and that distal row of carpals are the carpometacarpal joints. Sometimes you see this abbreviated to CMC. The metacarpals will also articulate with the proximal phalanges. And so here are your proximal phalanges right here. And these joints are going to be referred to as the metacarpophalangeal joints. So these joints right here and here are your MCP, or sometimes you just see MP. So let's talk a little bit about those phalanges. You will have three sets of phalanges. You will have proximal, middle, sometimes you see them referred to as intermediate, and distal. So these will, the green will be the proximal, intermediate will be in blue here, and then the distal are these very uniquely shaped phalanges, and these are your distalmost bones. Now, you have five proximal, five distal, but what's going on here? You only have four intermediate or middle, and that has everything to do with that first digit. And it is, you do not have a middle or intermediate phalange in your first digit. So you only have the distal and the proximal. Now, going back to these other sets that have all three, the joint between the proximal and the intermediate, so right here and right here, these are your proximal interphalangeal joints, or your PIP. You very often hear that. It's kind of a long name to say, so you use this abbreviation often. Whereas the joints between the intermediate and the distal phalanges, as you can see here and here, are going to be your DIPs, or your distal interphalangeal joints. And so if you look at the actions that you can do with these joints, these proximal interphalangeal joints in your distal, it's really only, these are kind of these hinge joints, so they're only flexing and extending. We call this joint here, since we don't have the intermediate, we just call this the interphalangeal joint, or the IP joint, or the first IP joint. All right? Okay, so that was a whole lot of bones, but we did that pretty quickly in terms of the wrist and the hand. So it's not that they're not as important. They're just not as many muscle attachments that are some of those larger muscles that we typically talk about in musculoskeletal anatomy. So we can kind of group these in nice groups and get those big picture concepts. Okay, question. And if you don't get this right off the bat, let's kind of pause it and go back to your notes. So I want you to tell me which is the most frequently fractured carpal bone. Is it the capitulum, the hamate, the lunate, the scaphoid, or the trapezium? All right. So one of these is not even a carpal bone, right? Let's go back and look at that picture. Which one of these is not a carpal bone? Well, it's not the capitulum. I think you can have to make sure that you kind of get these names down, because some of the names can be pretty similar. So if you're looking at this question, the capitulum is not even a carpal bone. The capitate is, but the capitulum isn't. And remember, you think about that more in terms of the distal humerus. Hamate, lunate, scaphoid, and trapezium, they are carpal bones, so they are potentially correct. And it is that most lateral bone of the proximal row, or the scaphoid, that is going to be the most frequently fractured. It's not to say that these other bones can't be fractured. They certainly can. Hamate is, it's not all that infrequent. Lunate is more commonly dislocated, but can be fractured as well. Same thing with trapezium, but it's really that scaphoid that has the higher frequency in terms of fracture rate. And that's why we talk about it, also because you can really get into having a better understanding of avascular necrosis occurring in areas where you don't have a very robust supply and a fracture occurs. The scaphoid is one of the common areas. The neck of the femur is going to be another area where avascular necrosis is more common. And it has everything to do with you need that robust supply. And if you don't have it, that can cause for bone death to occur. And we know that from our conversations regarding the bone tissues as well. All right, thank you for your time and attention here. We have gotten through all the bones of the upper limb. Now we're going to talk about some of the selected major joints of the upper limb. So we're getting into some fun ligaments and all kinds of fun in terms of actions. Thanks for your time and attention, and have a great day.